Hey guys, welcome to the fourth, if I can call it, episode of the sequence that I mean of the chapter that we're doing on, which is about job scheduling. So as a reminder, we did the first part, which was the theory. Second part was the assignment model, where we used only three steps: step one, two, and four, because we didn't need to use step two as it was already optimal. So the third video that we did was still on the assignment model, but where we had to use the four, how do we call them? Where we use the four method or four steps. Now, today what we're going to do is about job sequencing. Now, as we say, job sequencing is this method of assigning jobs depending to job sequencing using priorities. So it's this method of allocating jobs, or at least scheduling, whereby we allocate job based on different priorities. Even you as student, there's still some chapters or there's still some of those modules that you don't really give the same energy like other modules. There are some of those modules you need to prepare maybe 2 days, even a week before, compared to other ones. You are giving priority based on the final output that you want. So this is the same thing in the company. They have different priorities. There are some jobs that can be done before because they'll generate more income, or there are some jobs that will be done maybe later because they are just taking too much time. Even you, when you're writing a test, there are some questions that you say, this one, because it's too easy, I'm going to solve it now, or I'll solve it at the end. And the one that is too long, I'm going to solve it after. It's a way of prioritizing. But generally, there are many priorities that a company can use. But the most known is the first come, first serve, the first one. The second one, the shortest processing time. The third one is the earliest due date. Here we start with the job that is really required. If a job is due tomorrow, I'm going to do it first, and then I'll do the one that is due after, later. Then you have the longest processing time, you have the short, and so on. So those are the methods that we can use. Now, I got an exercise here, which is about this company that have they have 6 jobs that they need to solve, or they need to prioritize. They need to know which priority they're going to use, which priority rule they're going to use. So we need to assess all of them and see how they're going to use different sequencing. So the first priority rule, by the way, solving that deciding comes with these formulas here. We need to find the average completion time, the utilization metric, the average number of jobs in the system, and so on. So you need to know these formulas, whether they're given to you or not, you need to know them. So now, coming back to for the sequencing job, we need first of all to identify which one are the priority rules. We'll start with the first one, which is the first come, first serve. So the first come, first serve with this method, you realize that every time that you are doing the priority rules, you'll always be given a table like this with the number of jobs, the processing time, and the due date. Now, you always need to make sure that the number of units is the same. You know, here we're talking about days. In the previous one, it's also about days. So it's always days and days. So make sure that whenever you get a problem like this, you always make sure that the same number of unit. So how do you solve it? First of all, you replicate the table. Like what I've done, you are doing the first come, first serve. First come, first serve, this is the sequence that you use, that the jobs are being processed the way they come. Job A came first, job B came first, job C, D, and E, and F, they came first. So this is what we're going to do first. And after that, we will go on to another, we will go back to another priority. It's more like this applies more, for example, to bank, whereby there's no priority over the customer. No matter the amount of money that you need to deposit, no matter the problem, if you find people, you need to wait for them to be serviced first. But it's not really applied in things like hospital. You might be there because you have a headache and someone is an emergency, is going to go in first. So it's another way of priority. Now, in this case, we have the first come, first serve. That means the jobs, they're going to be aligned like that. So we just copied and paste the table here. But now we need to make a total of the processing time by adding the value. We add one more column, which is the flow time. And then we're going to add another column at the end, which is the job lateness. So the flow time actually is the cumulative values of the processing day. So you will take 6, because we start with 6, plus 12, which will give you 18. Then you get 18 plus 14, which gives you 32, like this. And the 32 plus 2 gives you 4. At 34 plus 10 gives you 44. 44 plus 4 gives you 8. Now, whatever you have as a floor time, you can also add it. Just you get 6 plus 18 plus 32 plus 34 plus 44 plus 8, which gives you 142. So 6 plus 18 plus 32 plus 34 plus 44 plus 8. Yes, you get 142. Now, the job lateness, this is the column here. How do you find it? The job lateness, actually, we just want to know, are we late with the job compared to the due date? This job here was due on day 22, but we finish it on day 6. Are we late or not? We're not late because we did it on time. It was supposed to be done after 22 days, but we only did it after 6 days. So we are on time. Now, because we are on time, there's no lateness, it's 0. Another way to identify would be by taking 6 minus 22. If you get a negative number, you put a 0. If it's a positive number, you put that positive number. So 6 minus 22 will obviously give you a value of 18, if I'm not mistaken now. 6 to 32, it gives you a value of 16, negative 16. So because it's negative, you put a 0. In this case, you get 18 minus 14, which gives you 4. So since it's a positive number, it's more like the job was due on day 14, but we finish it on day 18, so we are 4 days late. Same thing applies for job C. It was supposed to be done on day 30, but we finish on day 32, 2 days late. This other one was supposed to be done on day 18. We finish it on day 34, so we have 16 days late. So 44 minus 25 gives you 19 days late. And we have, by the way, this one is supposed to be 48 because it's a cumulative. 44 plus 4 gives 48. Yeah, so 6 plus 18 plus 32 plus 34 plus 44 plus 48. I don't know if my calculation are correct because I'm checking. Total, it's 182. Sorry. 182. Yes. So now what we do is like we have 19, which coming from 44 minus 25. Then here we take 48 minus 34, which gives us 14. It means that this job here, we are 14 days late. We're supposed to complete it on day 34, but we finish it on day 48. So what do we do? We can still take the sum of the job lateness here. You can still take 0 plus 4 plus 2 plus 16 plus 19 plus 14, and you get a total value of 55. Yeah. So one thing that you can do now, you go back to the formulas, you can solve now using the average completion time, utilization metric, and so on. So in this case here, we can use the average completion time. So the average completion time, the formula is, you take the sum of the total floor time divided by the number of jobs. The sum of total floor time is 182, number of jobs is 6, and when you divide it, 182 divided by 6, you get an average of 30.3. Average completion time is 30.33 days. It means that most of the jobs that you are doing, you can complete them in average after 30.33 days. Then after that, we do the utilization metric. The utilization metric just compare how effective we are. Are we really, how often or what is? And this one, by the way, is a metric that means it must be in terms of percentage. So the formula is the total job work or the processing time divided by the floor time. So you have the processing time, the total here, which is 48. Divided by the sum of the floor time, which is 182. And because it's a metric, remember, we need to multiply it by 100. So we get 100 here. So we get 48 divided by 182 times 100. So the utilization metric is 26.37%. Then after the utilization metric, we use the average number of jobs in the system. Average number of jobs in the system. Now, according to that, the formula that it's an average, by the way. So the formula that you use is the sum of the total floor time, and then we divide by the total processing time. So you take the total, which is 182. Total processing time, it's 48. So you take 182 divided by 48 and you get an average of 3.79 jobs. This one is an average of a number of jobs, so it means that by an average we have almost 3.17 jobs per day. Then the last one is the average joblessness. So the average joblessness is about taking the total number of jobs that you joblessness, which is 55, that you are going to divide by the number of jobs, which is 6. So in the formula, you say the total late days divided by the number of jobs. So you get 55 divided by 6, which gives you 9.16. So it means 9.17. It means in average, whenever we have a job, we are late with 9.16. So yeah. Now this is how you solve the first come, first serve. The first come, first serve method. Now remember, whatever we have done is only the first come, first serve. You still have the shortest processing time. So the thing that you do, the shortest processing time, SPT, you need now to allocate also the job based on the priority, based on the processing time. So the job with the shortest processing time will be the first, and the one with the second processing time will be the second. What am I doing? So I can't even paste. So where are we right now? And this is my table. Well, so this is a new table. I'm gonna put it down. The shortest processing time. So we look at jobs, which one has the shortest processing time? We look at the cells here. So the job of the first shortest process time is D. That is the shortest process time of 2. So we're gonna remove it, and it's going to be the first. We start with D. After D, we get F because it has the shortest processing time of 4. We move it, yeah. And after 4, we have 2, 4. Then we would have A with a shortest processing time of 6. We put it here. Then we have B with, no, not B, E with 10. Then after 10, we got B and C, that is 12 and 14. So you realize that every time that we move with the whole column, I mean the whole row. So the sequence is going to be to do D, F, A, E, B, and C. So it means that all these values here, if we have to do them, we're going to start like that. And the principle is still the same. After doing that, we do the flow time and the joblessness again. So from here you have the flow time, then from the flow time you take the cumulative value, you get 2 again plus 4. 2 plus 4 gives you 6. Then you have 6 plus 6, 12. 12 plus 10, 22. 22 plus 12, you get 24. Then you get 24 plus, which gives you 38, if I'm not mistaken, 14 plus 24. Then after that, we do the joblessness. Joblessness. So for the joblessness, we do the same thing. This job was supposed to be done on day 18, but we finished it on day 2. So we are way on time. 2 minus 18 gives you negative 16, so you put a 0. Then the other one, you take 6 minus 34. You get a negative 28, so you get a 0 again. We finish it on time. Same thing for this one. It was supposed to be done on day 22, but we finished it on day 12, so we are way on time. The other one, again, same thing. They are on time. This other one was supposed to be done on day 14, but we finish it on day 24. So we are 10 days late. 24 minus 14 gives you 10. It's positive, and you put it in the value. This one, the same thing. 38 minus 30 gives you 8, which is positive. Then form A will still do the same thing, the job processing time, which is 2 plus 4 plus 6 plus 10 plus 12 plus 14, which gives you 48. Then the total here of 2 plus 6 plus 12 plus 22 plus 24 plus 38 gives you 104. And then the total of the joblessness is 18. So after doing that, the next thing that we do is we calculate exactly whatever we have calculated here, the average completion time and everything below. So the average completion time, remember, we're gonna take now the total of our flow time is not 102, it's 104, that we divide by 6, which gives us 17.33. So it should decrease from 30 to 17. Then the utilization metric, we take the 48, the total of the flow time that we have here, we divide by the total of the flow time, which is 104 again. Yeah, so you take 48 divided by 104 times 100, which gives you 46%. Actually, it's 46.15. And then after that, we have the average number of jobs in the system. You still take the flow time, which is 104, that you divide by the number of jobs in the system, which is 104 divided by 448, which gives you 2.16 times 100. You get average number of jobs, sorry, it's 108 divided by 48. So the value that you get is, or it's a number of jobs, so it's gonna be 2.17. Then after that, you take the average joblessness. In this case here, we have 18. So you have 18 divided by 6, that will definitely give you 3 days late. So in average, we have a lateness of jobs, that is most of the time 3 days and so on. This is how you solve the shortest processing time. Now, by analogy, I don't see a point of us of solving the longest processing time, but I feel like there's a point for me to explain to you how you will be able at least to do the sequencing part. So what we do is you copy this, and because we always need this table, so it's LPT. It's still not there. They don't see it. So for the longest processing time, we look at the table the way it is right now. We look at the job. Actually, it's the opposite of the short processing time. So here we'll start with the job that has the longest processing time, which is 12. I mean, which is B with no, it's not B with 12. It's C with 14. It's gonna be the first job. Then after C, we go to B with 12. Then after B, we go to E with 10. Then after E, we go to A with 6, because it's the job that has this longest. And then after, we have F with 4, like this. Then after doing that, what you guys are supposed to do is you do again the flow time here. So for this one, you can do it on your spare time, but I'm not doing it. You do the flow time. After doing the flow time, you do the job lateness, and you find the value. So the sequence is gonna be C, B, E, A, F, and D. This is the sequence as long as the longest processing time is concerned. We can still try to do the same thing if we are working out for that. So after doing that, you go back to using these formulas again. The numbers that you find in the table, you solve them, so it's still the same. There's nothing new. Then another thing that you can do, which is the fourth method now, which is the earliest due date, EDD. Let me find my table. So this is the initial table. Remember, every time that you need to work on, you turn back to the initial table to take the values. Now from here we have the earliest due date. Where is it? Sorry, not this one here. So I don't know my table is. Well, okay. So with the earliest due date, what you do is from here. Now I took the wrong table. So I'm gonna take this job. This is the table. And this one here goes back to this one, the table for the RPT. Now from here we have the earliest due date. We look at the table again. The job of the due date, we are looking at this column here. The job of the earliest due date, like the smallest value, is gonna be prioritized. In this case here, we're gonna give B to be the first job, like this, and after B, we got D to be the second best. 18, after 18 you get 22, so not changing. After 22 we need to get 25, and after 25 we get C and D, which is 30 and 34. So the sequence is going to be B first, then we go to D, then A, then E, then C, then F. So this is how you do, and after that you still do the same process again. You do the floor time, and after the floor time you do the job lateness. The reason why I'm not doing it, as I told you, is because the formula is still the same. You still need to find out. I can even fill this table here. As I told you, we start with 12. 12 plus 2 get 14. 14 plus 6 is 20. 20 plus 10 you get 30. You get 44, and then you get a 48. Then from here you calculate the job lateness. 12 minus 14 gives you a negative number, it's 0. 14 minus 12, negative 0. 20 minus 22 is still 0. This one is a positive 30 minus 25. Then 44 minus 30, you get a positive value of 14 too. And then 48 minus 34, you get a positive value of 14. 14. Then you can still do the total here, which is supposed to give you 48, and the total here, 12 plus 14 plus 20 plus 30 plus 44 plus 48, you get a value of 168. Then the job lateness is 14 plus 14 plus 5, which gives you 83. So from there we have the values again. We come back to the initial part here of the formulas. So you just replace again the values that are here, you replace, and then you find. So you might ask me, coming back to the slide here, you might ask me which one is the best method. And even if you have to solve it, if this question is asked to you, there are no best method. It works in different, how do you call it, different companies, different organizations use different procedures. As I told you, the bank works with a first come, first serve. Like the first one who comes is the one that's gonna serve. But there are also some other systems that work with a shortest processing time. Like the job that requires less time to be proceed, we're gonna start with it. And the one that is longest, we're gonna finish with it later. So it depends on the company. No method is better than the other one. So this is all about the sequencing job. One thing that you just need to do is you can try to work it out, to work the table and to replay the formulas. But the most important thing is to understand how you sequence the job based on the different priority roles. So thank you so much for your time. I really hope that this video was really helpful, and see you next time.